Hello, this is Lazarus at Telecom Tech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining VNIs, VTEPs, and VXLAN architecture. If you like my content so far and you're interested in seeing more networking and telecom technologies simply explained, then please subscribe now to the channel. If you like this video, make sure to click that thumbs up button. In a previous video, we introduced VXLAN and I shared with you why it is needed and what developments in networking have encouraged its use. In this video, we'll start talking about some of the components involved in the deployment of VXLAN, and specifically, we'll be talking about VNIs and VTEPs. Now, what are VNIs? VNI stands for VXLAN Network Identifier. This has a similar function to the VLAN ID that's used by the more traditional 802.1Q standard for Ethernet. It is used to uniquely identify a layer 2 domain or segment. Now, the VNI is represented using a 24-bit number, which means that you can define over 16 million VNIs. That's a huge increase compared to the 12-bit value provided by the VLAN ID, which gives us just over 4,000 VLAN IDs to work with. Now remember, VXLAN actually encapsulates layer 2 frames within UDP datagrams. Now when this is done, there's an extra VXLAN header that is added to the frame. The VNI value is actually defined within that VXLAN header, but we'll talk more about that shortly. Now what are VTEPs? Now, VTEP stands for VXLAN Tunnel Endpoint. This is the device that is responsible for encapsulating and decapsulating the layer 2 frames within a VXLAN tunnel. This device is connected to the underlay network, and it creates the tunneling mechanism for the overlay network. Now remember, VXLAN was created primarily for use in data centers and cloud-based infrastructure, where there are many virtual machines and containers. This vast increase in end devices has increased the number of MAC addresses, as well as the number of layer 2 domains required. Now, because VXLAN is applied in such infrastructure, VTEPs can actually be either software-based or hardware-based. Now, software-based VTEPs are those software switches that are typically used within a hypervisor that hosts the end virtual devices. Hypervisors will typically have a software switch dealing with the network connectivity of the individual virtual devices and containers that it hosts. Thus, this software switch can be a VTEP. But VTEPs can also be hardware-based. That is, they can be configured within a hardware switch. In that case, the location at which encapsulation and decapsulation take place is in the hardware switch itself. So the VTEP functionality is something that you enable and configure within your hardware or software switch. Now, because we're going to be approaching VXLAN from a primarily Cisco point of view, we'll be focusing on hardware VTEPs and their configurations. However, the same principles and logic behind the configurations are the same for software VTEPs as well. So how are VNIs and VTEPs used in a VXLAN topology to create VXLAN tunnels across the underlay network? Well, let's take a look at this VXLAN topology. Here we have three switches acting as VTEPs for VXLAN. We can see that layer 2 tunneling has been established between them. And these switches, along with this whole VXLAN infrastructure, are actually logically operating as one huge layer 2 switch that can be segmented into millions of layer 2 segments. Now let's say we want to create three VNIs, or three layer 2 segments, to be interconnected over this topology. So we have three layer 2 segments that we want to tunnel across the underlay network, and each of those segments is assigned a VNI. Specifically, the VNIs that we've assigned are 6501, 6502, and 6503. Now, each VTEP will have two interfaces, that are involved in the process of tunneling. The first is the VTEP IP interface, which is the physical interface to which the underlying network is connected. This is a layer 3 physical interface, which is assigned an IP address on the underlying network. As long as IP connectivity is available between VTEP IP interfaces, then we can have VXLAN connectivity. And then we have the VNI interfaces. Now, these are logical interfaces that correspond to the VNIs that this particular VTEP serves. Now, these are similar to switched virtual interfaces, or SVIs, in more traditional VLAN environments. A VTEP can thus be configured with multiple VNI interfaces. However, each of these VNI interfaces is associated with the same VTEP IP interface. Thus, multiple VNIs are tunneled through the same physical interface, much like a trunk. Now, each VNI configured in a VTEP essentially creates a separate layer 2 segment. Now, before I end off, I'd like to give you a sneak peek into what we'll be talking about in the next video. This here is an illustration of the encapsulation that takes place using VXLAN. As you can see, we have the data, which is encapsulated within an IP packet, which is then encapsulated into an Ethernet frame. Now, this frame is a layer 2 entity, and it is then encapsulated into a UDP datagram. But before we add the UDP header here, we first add a VXLAN header. Now, if you can't get your head around this so far, not to worry. We'll be taking a more detailed look at this tunneling process in the next video. For now, I'd just like to emphasize the information that is maintained within the VXLAN header. This header is 8 bytes in length. The first byte contains 8 flags, where the I flag, which is the 5th flag, must always be set to 1 for any valid VNI. The other 7 bits, designated by the letter R, are reserved fields for future use and must be set to 0 on transmission, and they must also be ignored by the receiving VTEP. The next 24 bits are also reserved for future use. Then we come to the VNI field itself, and this is, as we said before, a 24-bit field. This is where the value of the VNI is stored. And for the duration of the transmission of the frame over the VXLAN infrastructure, this is the field that tells the VTEPs to which VNI this frame belongs. It is added upon encapsulation at ingress on a VTEP, and it is read and removed upon egress of the destination VTEP. Finally, we have one other byte at the end of this VXLAN header, which is also reserved. Now, as you can see, the technology has been designed to be future-proof and to be able to incorporate new functionalities by taking advantage of these available reserved fields for the future. Now, in the next video, we'll see more practically how this VXLAN header is used and how encapsulation and decapsulation takes place on a VXLAN topology. So that's it for today. I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please do click that thumbs up button. And if you'd like me to address other related topics, feel free to let me know in the comments below. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.